لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
الحمد لله الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده ألا من لا نبي بعده ولا أمة بعد أمته ولا كتاب بعد كتابه ولا شريعة بعد شريعته أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذي فرض عليك القرآن لرادك إلى معاد صدق الله العظيم. Respected viewers, we begin by praising Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and send salutations upon our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran declares that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favors upon you that he has sent a Rasul and a Prophet min anfusihim, from amongst you, from amongst humankind. When he said in Surah Ali Imran in the fourth juz of the Quran, لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. I have done a tremendous favor upon you by sending from amongst your own kind a Nabi and a Prophet who will read the verses of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you, who will teach you the book of the Almighty Allah, will teach you wisdom, will teach you the message of Almighty Allah, and will teach you aspects of how to lead your life. And he is a perfect example. In our last program on the slot, we spoke about the preparations of the Muslims towards conquering Makka. We gave the example of how Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gathered people. And the reason for this was the breaking and violation of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah by the allies of the Quraysh, the Bani Bakr, against the allies of the Muslims, Bani Khuza'ah, and how the Quraysh had helped the Bani Bakr in, and they took joy and relish in helping the allies against the allies of the Muslims. And when they broke the treaty, they tried to restore the treaty which Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not adhere or did not agree to, to them wanting to renew the treaty because the breaking and violation came from them. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam then got the Sahaba ready to go towards Makkah and for the conquest of Makkah. Hatib bin Abi Balta's letter, the reasons behind that letter and Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's response was also mentioned in the last program, where we learn the great lesson that when someone has served the community and has done well to the community, if there is a lapse, sometimes we need to be accommodating with regard to those lapses. These were aspects that we had dealt with in our last program. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam leaves Medina Munawwara on the 10th of Ramadan. And Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam goes towards, and on the way, also something that we looked upon in our last program was how two of the cousins of Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Abu Sufyan bin Harith bin Abdul Muttalib and Umayyah, the son of Atika bint Abdul Muttalib, how they came and they came to accept Islam. And Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam initially was reluctant to meet with them because of their past history in which they had maligned and they had composed poetry against Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then on the consultation and the advice of Umm Salma radiallahu ta'ala anha, and then they went to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who told them to approach Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam forgave them also. In this journey then, Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu also meets Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on the way. Now this is significant in the sense that Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu always remained in Makkah even after Hijrat. Ulama have differed. By and large, the ulama of the view that Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a Muslim, accepted Islam, but for other reasons, strategic reasons, and to keep Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam informed of happenings in Makkah Mukarramah, Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu hid his iman and he remained in Makkah. That is the most of the ulama and majority of the ulama are of this view. There are few who feel that it was this at time that he accepted Islam on the way when Nabi Karim Sallallahu was coming towards Makkah Mukarramah to conquer Makkah Mukarramah, the conquest of Makkah. And when Nabi Karim Sallallahu met him, Nabi Karim Sallallahu told him something which gives some sort of indications to the preference of that view that Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a Muslim all along. When Nabi Karim Sallallahu said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has culminated the obligation of hijrah with you the way he had culminated and perfected nabuwat with me. The way nabuwat was perfected and completed with me, the obligation of hijrah, that particular hijrah which was the distinguishing mark of a believer in that stage of Islam, that has been culminated with your hijrat. So your hijrat is the last of the hijrat that was compulsory, which was a sign of iman, without which a person could not be a Muslim. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has culminated hijrat with you the way he has culminated prophethood with me. Nabi Karim Sallallahu, bear in mind, Nabi Sallallahu leaves on the 10th of Ramadan. It is the month of Ramadan in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made roza faraz. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Whoever finds a month of Ramadan, let him fast. But bearing in mind, it is the hot Arabian desert. It is also one in which Muslims are going for a very noble cause. They are going to liberate Makkah Mukarramah from idol worshipping. And it is also an aspect in which they were going to be tired because they are in expedition. Nabi Karim Sallallahu, during the course of this journey, Nabi Karim Sallallahu publicly drinks water. And this was to tell the Sahaba that if you cannot manage to keep the fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given accommodation that those who are in travel, it is not compulsory for them to keep the fast. Our ulama have made mention that in many aspects there are these two types of commands, azimat and rukhsat. Azimat means taking that cause in which there is greater struggle. And rukhsat means that cause in which there is some form of accommodation. Fasting while traveling, if a person keeps it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him. But on the other hand, if a person doesn't fast while he is traveling, there is no sin upon him. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to emphasize this, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank water in front of all the companions to emphasize this fact. Also telling us that if, for example, you might have chosen the path of azimat, you must have chosen the path of greater effort and you kept fast. And after keeping fast, if you see another person who practices upon the accommodation by not keeping fast, and you are traveling on a plane, and you are fasting in the month of Ramadan, and the other one chooses not to fast because of the accommodation, that fasting in Safar is not compulsory. There is no sin upon him. Don't look down upon that action. It is not a haram action. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, during this journey, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam drank water in front of everyone. So he gave the people the leeway that there is also this accommodation that people can also sometimes use that accommodation, and there is no harm in that. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam continues, in Qudayd, the Bani Sulaim, they joined Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with 900 people. And until Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam comes and camp at Marruz Zahran, which is some 10 or 12 or some kilometers away from Makkah Mukarramah. And then Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells every Sahabi to light a fire. Now, can you imagine 10,000 people, each and everyone lighting a fire in the wide expanse of the Arabian desert, where normally things can be seen at great distance, and each and everyone lights up the fire, and the people of Makkah, for the very first time, now come to realize that there is an army, there is a great force that is outside Makkah Mukarramah encamped. And before that, they were not aware of it. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made dua that, O Allah, do not let the people of Makkah know until I am camped outside Makkah Mukarramah. And this was to increase the awe of the Muslim army. And when the people of Makkah, they come out of Makkah during the night, and they see this great amount of fires that is lit out in the wide expanse outside Makkah Mukarramah, they start wondering, what is this? Who is this? Someone said it is the Bani Khuza'ah, because the Bani Khuza'ah, they allies Bani Bakr, helped by the Quraysh, had many of them killed, which was a violation of the treaty. Someone said it is a Bani Khuza'ah. And Abu Sufyan said, no, this can't be the Bani Khuza'ah. Bani Khuza'ah are not so great in number. And then Abu Sufyan, Hakim bin Hizam, Budayl ibn Waraqa, leave Makkah Mukarramah to go and investigate where is the fire emanating from. And we will continue with this after the break. Respected viewers, welcome back once again to our program, The Perfect Example. Just prior to the break, we are speaking about Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's journey for the conquest of Makkah. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam camps in Marru Zahran. 10,000 Sahaba light the fire. And the people of Makkah are taken aback. Where is this coming from? They suggested maybe it is a Bani Khuza'ah for reasons which we had made mention prior to the break. Abu Sufyan said this cannot be the Bani Khuza'ah. They are very small in number. He goes out to investigate. Three of them, Hakim bin Hizam, Budayl ibn Waraqa, and Abu Sufyan. Bear in mind, Abu Sufyan at that time, the leader of the Quraysh. And when they come nearby, they are taken into captivity. Muslims who were guarding the army, they find these three people and they bring them into the presence of Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As they are riding their mules and brought into the presence of Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, at that time Abbas radiallahu ta'ala meets Abu Sufyan and he tells Abu Sufyan, do you know who is this army? Abu Sufyan replies in the negative. He says, this is the army of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Abu Sufyan is taken aback. Leader of the Quraysh, always hostile in the enmity and forefront in the enmity against Muslims. And Abbas tell him, Abu Sufyan, is the time not now right for you now to give up and for you now to acknowledge and to become a Muslim? And he doesn't say anything. He is brought into the presence. And as he's brought into the presence, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he jumps in joy and he jumps in glee, takes out his sword and accompanies Abu Sufyan in the presence of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a gift. Allah has made the head of the enemy in our hands without any effort from our side. Surely let us deal with him. And Nabi, he asks permission to execute Abu Sufyan. Ya Rasulullah, bear in mind, Abu Sufyan is the leader of the enemies. And here he is in the presence and at the mercy of the Muslims. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu said, Umar, wait Umar, I have given him asylum. I have given him protection. Let him come, let him listen and let him see us. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu then starts speaking to Abu Sufyan. Abbas radiallahu ta'ala rebukes Umar radiallahu ta'ala and says, Umar, had he been from Bani Adi, you would not have emphasized or insisted upon his killing. Bani Adi, he was the family of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But because he's from Bani Abd Munaf, bearing in mind Abu Sufyan is related to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if I'm not mistaken, in the sixth generation, as we had made mention, Heraclius called Abu Sufyan to give answers to his queries. When the letter reached Heraclius, and Abu Sufyan said, I am the closest amongst the trade delegation that was in that area at that time. So he's from Bani Abd Munaf. And Umar radiallahu anhu gives a remarkable reply. And said, Abbas, don't say that. Don't say that. Had it been from Bani Adi, I would not have emphasized and insisted upon his killing. Wallahi, your Islam gave me greater joy than even if my father had accepted Islam. Because your Islam gave joy to the Prophet of Almighty Allah. Such was the sacrifice and the love the Sahaba had for our beloved Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. May we be sacrificed and may we emulate such great love and devotion. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu then leaves his insistence. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam starts speaking to Abu Sufyan. And then he tells Abu Sufyan, you remain here. And Abu Sufyan spends the night in the company of Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The next morning when he gets up, Abu Sufyan sees this amazing sight, how the Muslims are making wudu and they are performing fajr and they are crying before Almighty Allah. They are a conquering army, but he looks at the humility. They are making dua to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sees a devotion when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is making wudu. They don't allow the water to fall down on the ground. And he is taken aback. And he said, what is this? Abbas radiallahu ta'ala explains to him. Then Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam summons Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan, Has it not now the time come for you to acknowledge the oneness of Almighty Allah? Leave your idol worshipping. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sovereignty and his control over the universe. And O Abbas, is it not time for you to acknowledge that I am the prophet and the messenger of the Almighty Allah? Abbas radiallahu also tells him, and Abu Sufyan says, I do acknowledge the greatness of Almighty Allah. I do acknowledge that you have been kind and beneficent upon us. You could have killed me, but I still have certain doubts. Allow me some time. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam allows him. Subhanallah, look at this. The enemy's head is here. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam could have executed him. But Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, give him time. Then Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is approached by Abbas. Oh, Prophet of Almighty Allah, Abu Sufyan is a person who covets honor. He likes respect. Give him some attention. Give him some sort of things that he could take with pride to take back to Makkah and Mukarramah. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Abu Sufyan, you see my army. It's unlikely that you will be able to resist. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has now brought me back to Makkah and Mukarramah. And it's unlikely you would be able to resist. Go and tell the people of Makkah, whoever takes refuge in the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. This is the first one. So Abu Sufyan gains the honor and recognition and respect that he craves. And yet he says, that will not be sufficient. Then he says, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, whoever goes into the Masjid-e-Haram, the sacred masjid, he is forgiven. We will not touch him. And Abu Sufyan said, that will also not be sufficient. There are more people in Makkah to be able to be accommodated in the Masjid-e-Haram. Whoever remains in his home, he would also be safe. Hakim bin Hizam, etc., who came with Abu Sufyan, they accepted Islam. And then when Abu Sufyan gets this from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he starts leaving. Abbas radiallahu ta'ala then says, is it not now the time for you to accept Islam? Some riwayats make mention. Some narrations said that he accepted Islam at that time. Some said he accepted Islam the next morning. Be as it may, Abu Sufyan rushes now back to Makkah and Mukarramah. When he rushes back to Makkah and Mukarramah, the people of Makkah gather around him. Obviously, they had to gather around him. The reason being that Abu Sufyan was the leader. He went to go and see the source of those 10,000 fires being lit. Everyone comes around him. And he comes and he has gained that particular type of respect and honor. And he says, oh, people of Makkah, the Muslims have come. They have got such a great army. You would not be able to deal with him. Before that, let me just give you another small. During the course of showing and speaking to Abu Sufyan, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tell the Muslim army to be able to show their strength. And then the Muslim different battalions come in front of Abu Sufyan. First comes Zubair ibn Awam radiallahu ta'ala, carrying the banner of the Muhajirin, and he had a yellow turban. And that battalion is led by Zubair ibn Awam with a yellow turban. And then the Ansar come, led by Sa'd bin Abi Wada. Then afterwards his son Qais bin Sa'd. Thereafter Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam takes out his battalion, and it is full of metal armor. Only the eyes can be seen. And there is also a greenish tinge, in the sense that there is a greenish scarf that is put on by Muslims and by Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's battalion. And Abu Sufyan sees this and he tells Abbas, your nephew has got a great kingdom. And Abbas radiallahu anhu said, not a kingdom, a prophethood. Not a kingdom. He's not a worldly king to be able to impress and kill people or to be able to show his empire. He is a prophet of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bearing all those things in mind, Abu Sufyan, when he comes to the people of Makkah, oh, people of Makkah, you can't resist. The Muslims have got such a great force. Go back. These are three options. Either you come in my home, either you go in the Masjid-e-Haram, or either you keep in your own homes. And the Muslim army would not touch you. They would not harm you. Hind. Bearing in mind, Hind still got that particular type of hostility against Muslims, against Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Said, oh, people of Makkah, my husband has gone mad. He has gone insane. Don't listen to him. And Abbas radiallahu anhu said, leave my wife alone. You all know this was the aspect with regard to the lights and the fires that you saw last night. There is no one who will be able to resist the Muslims. I am giving you this option. And when he said these options, immediately the people of Makkah, they scatter around and they all go into the three options of safety for them. Either the house of Abu Sufyan, and he was later on to become a Muslim. So today we say, at that time he was an enemy. Now we can say Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Or they go to the house, or they go to the haram, and where Abu Sufyan had taken a guarantee from Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, anyone who's in the haram, anyone who's in the Makkah Mukarramah, in the house of Almighty Allah, the Baytullah, would not be harmed. And anyone who is in keeps in their own house, they would not be in any way harmed. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the next morning, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam leave with a force. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made mention of this in the Holy Quran. إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لَرَادُّكَ إِلَى مَعَادٍ. The one who has revealed the Quran upon you, he gives you a guarantee and a promise that you would come back to Makkah Mukarramah. The ulama say this ayat was revealed when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam made hijrat from Makkah to Medina. And at that time Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaving his hometown. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayat. إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ. The one who has revealed the Holy Quran here gives you a guarantee you will return back to Makkah Mukarramah. Allah's promise was coming through. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam enters into Makkah Mukarramah. We have come to the end of this program. Inshallah, we will take it on from here in our next program. May Allah give us the tawfiq of understanding the greatness of the Prophet of Almighty Allah and following him in every detail. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.